Hi, I'm Mike Cintolo, Chief Analyst of Cabot Growth Investor and Cabot Top 10 Trader. I'm here with your Cabot Weekly Review, recording this late Friday morning on December 1st. So it's been a pretty, I wouldn't say quiet week, but kind of an unchanged week, at least looking at the major indexes post-holiday. Started off relatively low volume, a little bit more volatility late in the week, but the indexes are kind of unchanged as we speak. That keeps most of the evidence positive. The longer-term trend is up by our measures, intermediate-term trend is up, and I am seeing more and more stocks and sectors. It's not an avalanche, but more and more things kind of hitting new highs, breaking out, acting well, just sort of a step-by-step process, okay? I will say, just because I do keep my antenna up for everything, sometimes too much stuff, usually better to keep it limited. But a couple of things, this week. Number one, and I'll show you this, is, chip stocks have been the leading growth group all year. They're still looking okay, but they're kind of, there's a little rotation out of that and sort of into the broad market. At this point, I'm not freaking out, but that and NVIDIA, which has kind of been kind of the flag bearer of all growth stocks, AI chips and everything this year, is okay. Again, it's okay, but it's kind of bears a little bit of watching. The other thing is, earlier this week, we did see some of these speculative, you can call them meme stocks, but the GameStops of the world have a day or two when they're up, 15 or 20% on no news, just basically traders playing around with it. Historically, anytime you see that, it's usually a little bit of a sign that there's a little, some short-term speculation going on. But especially in the past couple of years, we've frequently seen these 3, 4, 5 week rallies. We see that, and then the market starts to back off. So when you kind of combine that with early December is actually sort of a choppy period of time before kind of the late year run, it wouldn't surprise me if we see some more rotation, we see some discomfort, that sort of thing. But, so if you're a shorter term trader, that's something to note. And I guess I wouldn't be piling in, flooring the accelerator and go buy 10 stocks today per se. But I think overall, from a position trader standpoint, intermediate term trend, everything's looking good. Like I said, more and more stuff is looking good. And the broad market is even acting better with our 2-second indicator, the number of new lows, really remaining at tame level. So overall, I'm optimistic. Past couple of weeks, we've probably put, 15 to 18% of, percentage points of cash to work. We're still about 1/3 in cash, a little bit more actually. But, so like I said, I'm not anxious to put in, 20% more today. But if things hold together, and maybe if we do have a little shake the tree event in some of these persistent leaders, I do think it could provide some opportunities going forward. Right now, I'm optimistic, I'm putting money to work, but also taking it in a step-by-step gradual, fashion, okay? All right, enough of the preamble. Let's hop into the charts. I'm using MarketSmith, Productive Investors Business Daily. You can learn more at marketsmith.com. Get on my pen. So here's the NASDAQ so far. You can just see kind of from a top-down perspective, there's no real, I don't want to make too much of what the yellow flags, like, ooh, we're seeing this stuff, be careful. It's possible, that maybe the rally just ends and it's 2022, 2023 all over again. But at this point, it's very, you can see the NASDAQ actually gapped up. This was the CPI report, and that was at 14,000. And here we are, we're still a couple hundred points above it as I record this. So, it's hard to say there's much weakness in here, but there has been some churning, some selling on strength. We've had some straight up runs in a lot of stocks, okay? But from my perspective, like I said, on a shorter term basis, could we fill this gap? Could there be, that's a game anyone can sort of play on an intermediate term basis. So there's no question the trend is up, well above 25 and 50 day moving averages. And that goes for basically everything, not basically everything, but everything that I track. Here's the S&P 500 again, just kind of chopping straight sideways here, which is sort of what you want to see. And well above, there's a lot of daylight here. So if we did get a shake or some bad news hit the tape and the market was down a couple of percent, it wouldn't necessarily, you don't want to see it, but it wouldn't necessarily damage the intermediate term move, okay? And same thing, just running through the, here's the New York Composite. You can see there has been, so there is sort of this rotation now more into the broader market. Maybe this is, Mike, is this the start of when the QQQs fall 5 or 10% and the rest of the market goes up? I don't know about that, but like maybe we see it. We'll just see how it goes. But so far you're seeing, here's the New York Composite of just accelerating higher. MDY, not quite as strong, some of these, but here's MDY popping higher. IWM, obviously small caps. Again, still kind of the worst thing out there, small caps. But they've actually been, it's hard to see on this chart because there's a lot of stuff on there. But this thin blue line is relative to the S&P 500. So you can kind of see the bottom was actually in here on the relative performance line. So it's been kind of rounding out here, I guess is what I'm trying to say. The last few weeks, maybe you're seeing some small cap outperformance. We'll see how it goes. Again, more important to me is the fact that all of these on an intermediate term basis are above their 25, 50-day moving averages, so the trend is up, you know, on that note, okay? Beyond that, also, just even though I'm talking about growth and stuff, which I'll get into, you know, here's the ARK fund, pretty persistent move. Obviously, the trend is up. IPO fund, not quite as strong, but still well above its moving averages, trending up. What else? Oh, IWO, which is small cap growth, you know, similar to the general small cap, but again, you know, 25-day line trending higher here. So much higher than it was 5 weeks ago, of course. So TWLO, the intermediate term trend is up. And there's other, you know, you could look at, this is the IBD 50 index, which is kind of proprietary to IBD. So you have to have Market Smith or an IBD product to get it. But again, it's a daily chart, so it's not updated like through this morning or whatever. But you can just see it's been a, number one, it's been a pretty persistent, you know, move up here in the last few weeks. And again, same sort of picture, a lot of daylight. So intermediate term trend is up. So even for growth, it's still been really good. You know, you look at the TLT, these are secondary, but this is, you know, bonds, of course, TLT, same thing, kind of intermediate term trend is up. This is 20 plus year treasury bonds. IEF is a ETF with, I guess, what is it, 7 to 10 year treasury bonds. You know, there's probably all sorts of, I don't know all the bond funds, but, you know, I keep an eye on these, obviously, because it's been the, you know, the tail wagging the dog here the last couple of years. So the trend here is up for bonds, which means for rates, the intermediate term trend is down, so on and so forth. So long story short, there's a lot of good stuff out there. Last thing I'd just point out, you know, we talked about the broad market, but here's financial stocks. They've really, you know, a lot of people talk about them, including me, when they're weak, because, you know, when they really start to get weak and the market's kind of weak, you wonder if something can come loose in the system. And you can see it was almost a retest of sorts here. This is the XLF. It was kind of a retest of sorts here. This was the, the SVB blow up. And there was multiple retests here in April and May. But it was almost a retest of that low. So you kind of have this, whatever that is, 6 months or not 7 months, I guess it is, sort of bottoming process. And now it's really, you know, powerful on the upside. So that's, you know, that's good to see. Now on the I don't want to say warning side, but what I was talking about earlier. So again, when you look at this is the SMH, it looks honestly fine. So, I mean, honestly, if you were an ETF trader or whatever, and a lot of chip stocks look fine too, obviously. So it looks pretty normal so far. I would say though, that given the fact, number one, like RP line wise, short term, it did hit a high a couple of weeks ago. Again, we've seen some rotation into other areas, not abnormal, but let's see how it goes. And then you have like NVIDIA, which I guess, the way I look at the market is through leadership. I mean, it's trends of the market up here, and then over here, it's action of leading stocks. And you kind of want both in gear. You don't, I mean, sometimes you have like the indexes haven't quite kicked into gear, but the leading stocks look great, like early 2020 or, you know, right after the crash. But, you know, so this has kind of been the number one leading stock. NVIDIA got hit. It's kind of got this little double toppy at 500. It's not, right here, it's not bad. I'm just keeping an eye on it. If you see NVIDIA open up, does it guarantee the market is toast? No, but I would just say all things equal. It's kind of like what we say about financials. You know, the financials don't have to lead the way higher, but you just don't want to see them, you know, coughing up blood sort of thing. You don't want to see something like NVIDIA and chip stocks, which have been leading, open up on the downside. And I wouldn't say, you know, I'm not predicting that's going to happen, but just it's been a little bit of a pullback in here. You have seen some distribution. To this point, it's normal. But if we have another week or two like this, or a few days like this, to be honest with you, this week, you know, and NVIDIA's down here somewhere next week, yeah, that might be a little bit dicey, at least on the growth side of the equation. We'll see what happens. Maybe that money flows in the broad market, but just something to keep an eye on. The other thing I was just going to say, get my notes up here. Yeah, you got your GME. It has come back down, I think, a little bit. But so you can just kind of see here. I mean, I don't have the percentage gains, but the stock went from, you know, 12 to 17. You've seen some of these, like here's in June, the stock had this, you know, huge run for it's just these 3 or 4 day moves, not on earnings or anything, just kind of speculation, you know. It would be one thing if the company reported great earnings and GameStop went up, hey, no problem. But so, you know, you had stuff like this was partially earnings, but you just had, you know, just wild moves down on earnings, right back up. And that tended to be a little bit a couple weeks ahead of, you know, the market top or whatever. So we'll see how it goes. You know, Wayfair is another one. Again, it's not, Wayfair is not like back up to 91 here, but it's hard to see on these charts, maybe the weekly. You know, just take my word for it. But I mean, you know, this week the stock was up 20% at one point, you know, on, I don't think there was any news. There's a couple other kind of lower priced examples. So we'll see how it goes. It doesn't mean, I'm not saying Wayfair or GameStop, I'm bearish on, I mean, they could easily go higher. I'm using it more as a market tool. So let's just see what happens. In the past, what we'd like to see is a character change, which is that you see some speculative stocks go up, and then they consolidate a little bit, and maybe they go up further, but it doesn't affect the market as a whole. That's usually what happens. You know, maybe short term, the market pulls back. The last couple of years, it's been kind of a pretty good sign that the sellers are going to show up. So just something I'm keeping an eye on here. But overall, when it comes to everything, you know, the, most of the evidence is positive. Our my market timing indicators are positive. Interest rates, so to speak, are positive, meaning that the trend of rates is starting to come down. So, you know, like I said, I'm optimistic, looking to put money to work, and I am putting money to work, okay? One other thing, just because I got a couple of questions on stuff like this, I'm starting to get some questions on, I own, you know, what do you think of this stock that I really didn't sell? It's down 1,000,000%. And now it's starting to pop up. Should I sell it? Should I hold it? You know, that sort of thing. So two things, a couple things. One, in general, so let's just look at DocuSign. This is DOCU. If you own a stock like this, it's really a couple of things to remember. Number one, you want to make the money back. You don't have to make it back in this stock. Okay, I write that quite frequently. So you want to make the money back. Doesn't mean you have to make it back in DocuSign or whatever the stock is that you own, okay? Number one. Number two is that, you know, if the market is supportive, which it looks like it is, okay, some of these things can come back and surprise on the upside. At this point, though, you do have some evidence of, you know, where the buyers are. In other words, we've had, whatever, 4 or 5 weeks of generally rallying. Is the stock really powering ahead? Is there an earnings gap? Is there volume coming in? You know, at least on a short-term basis, you could say, oh, well, maybe this thing could run for a little bit. Okay, so I would be looking at stuff like that. So here's DocuSign. It's up today, 5%, so that's pretty good. But you know, it's buried, it doesn't look good, it hasn't shown much. So, I mean, it's how you want to handle it. The way I would try to handle these things is, you know, you piece out of it, hopefully on the way up, and put the money into real leadership, okay? Now you compare something like this to, say, a Twilio. Now Twilio to me, this is TWLO. It doesn't look great right here, but it does have this, you know, whatever year and a half long base or year long base, number one. You do have some skyscrapers down here, okay, which is, you know, volume clues, big invest. And these are liquid stocks here. And there is resistance up here, don't get me wrong, but the numbers are, you know, the sales growth is decelerating, but the profits are strong. You know, it's not 100 times earnings or, you know, 30 times sales anymore. I don't know what the valuation is, but it's more reasonable. I guess it's 36 times trailing earnings here. So, but you've seen some action here. So you can still piece out of it, but these are the ones maybe you say, hey, maybe there's a willingness for some of these stocks to continue on the upside. You know, another one that actually looks pretty good is Cloudflare, NET, net. Again, it got absolutely destroyed, 80% or something, the bear market. And it's basically had, you know, just an endless bottoming process. This was a little bit, more well-controlled, not tighter, but more well-controlled. And now it's kind of threatening again. It's kind of up to resistance. So to me, these things are unlikely to, you know, be the, it, say the market does go up for 6 months or whatever from here, knock on wood. These are unlikely to be your true leaders. That said, you do have, you know, some volume clues here. You do have some sales growth, earnings growth. You do have obviously sponsorship. So if you want to give some of these a chance, peace out on the way up, but give some of them a chance. Give the ones a chance that have shown some strength, that have shown some earnings gaps, the ones that can barely get off their knees. Yes, maybe they kick into gear, but what if the market pulls back here? What if the NASDAQ pulls back and the broad market does well? Maybe those are the ones that really get hit, okay? So just something to consider because I am starting to get some of those questions. Longer term or, you know, over time, you want to be in gear with the market and what's working. Okay, enough of that, off the soapbox. Let's get into stocks that look good. So it's really a variety of things I'm seeing here. And I'm just picking out just names, see if Market Smith works. Yeah, just names. I've mentioned Datadog before. In fact, I wrote it up in Growth Investor yesterday. This is kind of its peer, which is Dynatrace. It's not as dynamic. Growth is projected to be a little slower. I mean, we'll see what happens there. But just noticing this three-week sort of volume cluster, I think before and maybe on earnings and after earnings, I think they had a share offering in here and it didn't really hurt the stock. And now it's kind of, this is like a lot of these names, and you can see it's very persistent here more recently. It is back into resistance like Twilio, like Cloudflare. Maybe that's one reason why you're seeing the NASDAQ hesitate a little bit. Okay, so maybe it pulls back or whatever, but Dynatrace is kind of interesting, sort of a longer term story. Outside of growth, I still like the action in home builders. Today, they're actually moving a little bit, but you can just see just, you know, it's kind of almost, it's almost too good. And it's sort of just straight up and then straight sideways, straight up and straight sideways. I mean, this is kind of what you would draw in a textbook, which the market rarely conforms to, you know. So we'll see, you know, there's resistance up here. This is the ETF ITB. We'll see what happens. Toll Brothers, the one thing I would say is Toll is one of the leaders. They do have earnings next, let's see, the 5th. So that's Tuesday, I guess. I'm not sure, morning or night. So that could affect the group or whatever. But again, the action's pretty good. So home builders, housing stocks look pretty good. We are seeing some earnings moves today. One of them, this is UiPath, P-A-T-H. It's a little bit, it's lower price, but it's liquid. It trades a ton of shares. And we're starting to, even though this week has seen some hesitation, we've seen a lot of earnings moves, okay? And I'll mention some of them here, but Path today, you know, looks like volume's ridiculous. You know, it's a big move. I don't know where it closes the day. It's a lower price, not lower price, but $25 stock. So it's going to move around, but it's up 25% today. Snowflake, which is a name. Snowflake's interesting. I mean, it's almost, you wonder if it sort of missed its window where it came public and it had kind of that liquid leader written all over it. Like, this is going to work. It's a whole new sort of cloud, you know, the data cloud and all that stuff. But then we had the bear, you know, the valuation was insane, of course. Then we had the bear market. Now we've had this bottoming process. Mike, I thought you said you wanted stocks that are, you know, showing strength gapping up. Well, yeah, so it's okay to watch them. I'm just saying, let's see, can Snowflake really kind of leap out of here? Well, they reported earnings this week and it was good and their reaction was good, but there was some churning on it. You know, it's up here in resistance. So just a name I'm watching. It's big, it's liquid. If people really want to floor the accelerator, they could, but it's just a name to watch. You know, I'll mention Salesforce.com, CRM. Obviously, it's a mega cap name, $250 billion market cap. And it really just sort of took out, you know, blasted out of this, you know, June, July, October, that's 3 months through. So 4 month range, basically. And here we are on a gap on, you know, really, really big volume here on the upside. A nice follow through today. So obviously that looks good. How you want to handle it's up to you. And I'll just mention Pinterest, which I think I've mentioned before. It's just starting to stretch its legs here. Again, a lot of these have had big moves in the past month, which, you know, you don't want to leave your brain at the door in terms of buying and, you know, just forgetting that. At the same time, you know, they've also put in some of these things a year or more of bottoming or basing or whatever it is after the bear market. And so Pinterest sort of changing character was on earnings a month ago. And you can just see how tight, not to get too inside baseball, but just how tight and proper those weeks are. Like, you can barely see them on the chart. And now this week it's kind of following through a little bit on the upside. So that's good to see. Just moving through kind of a few more names. You know, this is Howmet Aerospace. I think I've mentioned this here. I know I wrote it up in CGI, but some of the aerospace stocks look good. They can trend. I know it's not cocktail party bragging. You know, Boeing is actually, Boeing's, this is one of these Dow stocks that's just gone, you know, what do you do with this? You know, just kind of straight down, straight up. There's been good news, but aerospace stocks do look good. A lot of them are improving. HWM, not only new highs here, but just kind of, again, a lot of these stocks haven't shown an ability, a desire, I should say, to pull back much, which is usually a good sign, okay? MicroStrategy, listen, Bitcoin, it's not my favorite thing, but, you know, there's no question that it's an interesting chart, and I'm not just a chart buyer, but, you know, if Bitcoin, you know, if it's a bull market, and I'm not saying it is, but I'm like, if it's a bull market that can really move and the speculative juices do get flowing, you know, that's kind of Bitcoin's, up Bitcoin's alley. And MicroStrategy is basically a direct play on that. That's what they do, is they buy a bunch of Bitcoin and hold them. So kind of an interesting sort of straight up rally here. And kind of the longer it can kind of hang in here, the better, okay? And just a couple of other names. So GitLab, I've mentioned before, GTLB. I'm just mentioning this because it's got earnings next week. So again, you have this endless base. I mean, I know it kind of shook out here. We have this sort of endless bottoming range or whatever you want to call it. And this area has been tighter. So kind of like Cloudflare. Remember I showed you the Cloudflare chart where it's kind of had all this up, down, you know, 30, 40%. And then you have this sort of multi-month consolidation down, but not totally crazy. So that's kind of like GitLab. GitLab's a different animal. It's thinner than Netflix, than Cloudflare, excuse me. But they have earnings on Monday, it looks like, so the December 4th. Just kind of a keep your eyes open, whether you want to play a gap or not, but just something to keep an eye on. MongoDB is another potential earnings play again on Monday. You know, this one did have, I kind of like these better, where they did have the run, so it, you know, it did come back. It did show, obviously, accumulation. Then it had this pullback, which on the big picture wasn't abnormal, right? I mean, sitting through that stinks, but, you know, it pulls back to the 40-week line. And now it's kind of racing higher into earnings on Monday. We'll see what happens. Obviously, it's hit some hesitation. There's some selling ahead of earnings at resistance. So just something to watch. And last but not least is just we are, you know, with the broad market moving, I mentioned like IWM, which isn't the strongest thing, but let's say like MDY, that's pretty strong, you know, starting to flex. We are seeing more like economically sensitive, which is a lot of these small broad market stuff. It's just, it's financials. It's just sort of, I don't want to say cyclical, but, you know, economically dependent, you know, more leverage to the economy sort of thing. So, you know, Martin Marietta is aggregates. And again, you're not talking about the most, it's a $450 stock. It's not going to go to 900 next month, but kind of a nice consolidation in here. It did show some power here after earnings right off the 40-week line. And it kind of has been hacking around here. Again, it's just been chopping around, up, down, oh, what's going on? And now it's trying to poke out here. So just something to keep an eye on. Maybe it needs more time. Maybe it shakes out. But if it can get going, that would be good. And then you have something like United Rentals, which is, you know, basically a huge rental equipment company for construction and all that sort of thing. And you can see it did, you know, it's basically built this, whatever, I'm going to say 9 month, it looks like 9 or 10 month consolidation in here. $500 looks like pretty key resistance. Again, you do what you want to. Maybe it hits 500 and fails and it's never heard from again. But type of name that, you know, if expectations for the economy are going up, if the Fed's off our back, obviously investor perception can improve. So just back to the market, you know, to sum up, I'm optimistic. I'm putting money to work. I do think we're starting to see a few shorter term signs, at least with growth stocks, you know, maybe the broad market, maybe some of these cyclicals or whatever can hold up and actually go up. But, you know, maybe some of these chip stocks, maybe they need to exhale a bit. Maybe they need to rest for a while. But overall, there's a lot of maybes, ifs, you know, what I'm saying, like this could happen. You're just kind of throwing some scenarios out. But if you just weren't paying attention and just showed up every night or every weekend and just checked the evidence, you'd say that the intermediate term trend is up. We haven't given up much ground. More stocks are hitting new highs. The broad market is healthy. And we're still seeing some positive earnings gaps that are gapping up and, for the most part, you know, holding up pretty well. So there's no question that from an intermediate to longer term perspective, the evidence continues to improve, which is why we continue to put money to work. Okay, that's all the time I have. Long video today. Thanks for listening. Be sure to come by again next week for another Cabot Weekly Review.